Last week, I talked to you about keeping up the good work and how Paul in Philippians was encouraging the church at Philippi to keep on going on for God. Be careful who they heard, because there was a lot of dogs, he said, that came into the church. What do you mean by that? People that brought false doctrine to the church. And let me tell you, church, there's a lot of folks out there bringing false doctrine into our church today. So you have to be careful who you listen to. But if you have a church and you have a pastor that preaches the truth from God's word, you ought to hang in there with it. And that's what Paul was encouraging the church to do. He said, don't forget where we started. We started with the absolute truth, and that's with Jesus Christ, and you stick with him. And he said, you got some good brothers that came along behind me that loves you and prays for you and encourages you and gives to you the truth of the gospel. He said, I want you to follow those. And he began to name them out, if you read Philippians, who they were. But he encouraged this church. And so God has been keeping me here for a couple of weeks. So I want to give you not only keeping up the good work, but today I want to talk about being content in that work. Content not only in the work of the Lord, but within your own lives. Within your own lives. When we look around us, we find a state of discontentment. We have unsatisfied people. Somebody say amen. We have unhappy people. Somebody say amen. Unhappy people. Unfulfilled people. And Lord, thank you, brother. Amen. That little one even knows. We even got some disgruntled people. You can't satisfy them regardless of what you do. Why? Because they're not content. They're unhappy. They're unsatisfied. And nothing will satisfy an individual in that mindset. We see a world where we are not happy if we don't have the next best thing. And then when we get the next best thing in our lives, we're looking for the next best thing. And we're never, never content. We want better relationships. We want better jobs. We want bigger homes. We want more benefit with pay and less work. We are never satisfied. We are never content. And we are very envious of those who have what we do not have. That's the world we're living in. And they don't realize that most folks, amen, who has something, work for it. The Bible says if you don't work, you don't eat. And a lot of things comes by being content as well as putting in the effort. And to be content, we have to put in the effort. Listen to what Paul says in chapter 4 of Philippians, verses 10 through 14. That's Philippians chapter 4, 10 through 14. He says, how I praise the Lord that you are concerned about me again. In other words, he's saying to this church, he said, I know that you have a tender heart in you, that you want to look out for me, and you want to provide, amen, some of my needs. He said, I thank the Lord that you are concerned about me again. I know you have always been concerned for me, but you didn't have the chance to help me. But he said, not that I was ever in need, for I have learned. Notice he said, I have learned how to be content with whatever I have. He said, I know how to live on almost nothing all with everything. Notice he says again, I have learned the secret of living in every situation through Christ who gives me strength. I have learned in every situation, whether it was full stomach or empty and plenty of little, for I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Listen, even so, you have done well to share with me in my present difficulties. He said, I thank you for your generosity. And sometimes there were times that you could not help and when you wanted to help. But I am grateful for it. But I want you to know one thing, church. He said, I have learned to be content in the situation God has placed me in. Matter of fact, he's in prison when he's writing all of this. He's in prison. He's in a Roman prison. So he's learned how to be content even in a jail cell. Hello? In every situation of Paul's life, he says, I've learned to be content. Whether I was in a bad situation or in a good situation, I learned to be grateful and thankful for what God has given me, even though it might be a trial or it might be a valley that I'm going through. I might be depressed, but he said, I've learned to be content. I might have finances problem, but I've learned to be content. I might have this going on, but I've learned to be content. And the thing is, today, have we learned to be content? Have we learned to be content? Because contentment must be learned. And that's why he illustrated that in these verses. And he says, I've learned. And you too must learn how to be content for what God has placed in your life. He said, not that I was ever, in verse 11, in need, for I have learned how to be content with whatever I have. How could Paul make such a bold statement? Because he knew that contentment lies not, listen to this, lies not in what he has, but in whom he knew and was. What does that mean, preacher? He was content because he knew the Lord had control of his life at this point. And if the Lord doesn't have control of your life, you'll never be content. If the Lord is not Lord of your life, then you'll never be content. And you know how you can tell people who are not content? They gossip. They complain about everything. Nothing is never good for them. Nothing satisfies them. They're always looking at the worst. Getting quiet in here. Come on now, church. They are people that are not content. If you're content, you have a heart of gratitude. Regardless of what you're going through or what's happening around you, you are thankful to God, amen, that he has placed you there at this particular time to learn how to trust him and to obey him. Paul knew how to be content because he's learned that God was in control of his life, and no matter what he was going through, no matter what valley, no matter what was happening around him, he was content because he knew God was in control. God was in control. When we are in a relationship with Jesus Christ, we understand who we are and what we have in Christ. You got it all when you got Christ. I mean, I loved that song back when I was a kid, and I wish I could find it today. It says, I don't have to settle for less because I'm a king's kid. And you never have to settle for less, amen, when you're a king's kid. Yeah, you might be going through a rough time, but learn to be content with it, because over the next hill we'll be home. I said over the next hill we'll be home, and then you'll have it all. You'll have it all. Contentment causes us to look vertical, amen, to God. When we look in his direction, regardless of our possessions or lack thereof, we know he's enough. He's enough. He's enough. But you know what lack of contentment make you do? Look horizontal at what others have. And when you look at what others have, you'll never be satisfied. You'll never be satisfied. Contentment is the secret of an inward peace God has promised each of us. It is also a reminder that we brought nothing into this world, and it certainly will carry nothing out of it. We'll carry nothing out of it. So what is contentment? A state of satisfaction, a state of peaceful happiness. God just loaned me the things that I have in my life. They're only temporal. And who would want the minimal of things here on earth when you have the greatest things in heaven? The cheapest thing in heaven is gold, and the streets are paved with it. Think of that. The streets of gold, the gates of pearl. So why would you want the minimal down here when you can have the greatest over there? So let the Lord, amen, teach you how to be content with what he has blessed you with down here, because it's just temporal. Things down here he blesses with is to bless others with. What do you mean? Everything that I possess that God has given to me down here will be somebody else's one day. So what he's blessed me with will bless others down the road. Somebody else going to live in that home you got. Somebody else will drive your car if it don't go to the junkyard first. Somebody else will ride that Harley. Somebody else will gain all your possession. So it's not really yours, is it? The house you live in, you quit paying taxes on it, guess who'll own it? The county or the city in which you live. So we ought to be just content that God has blessed us with and that we can use it daily. Amen. I'm grateful every time I get in it. I said, thank you, Lord. Amen. For this old truck. You know, thank you. Thank you for that Harley. Thank you for that old car you allow me to restore. Just thank you for it, that you allow me to use it for a little bit to make my life happy. Contentment is learned, and contentment is rooted in sufficiency. In 1 Timothy, Paul tells Timothy, if you got food and clothes, you ought to be content. If you got food and clothes, that ought to be enough right there to be content with. We all like to eat. I know I do. We all like to eat, so we ought to be thankful. I got some rags on my back. Thankful for a coat and a jacket to keep me warm. I'm thankful for a roof over my head. Aren't you thankful for that? Listen to what he said in 1 Timothy 6, 8 through 10. Having food and raiment, let us be therewith content. But they that will be rich fall into temptation. And a snare, he says, and into many foolish and hurtful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which some will convert after, that they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. He didn't say to have money was the root of all evil, but he said the love. The thing of being content is that, hey, you are thankful and grateful not only for the big things, but even the little things that God has placed in your life. You're not out to gain the world, because the Bible tells, what is the profit of man if he should gain the whole world and lose his soul? Is that you don't put those things in the material possession before God, he says. And if you do that, amen, he said, then you are content. You don't put the material things before God, then you have a heart of contentment. But if you put those material things before God, and you're seeking after the dollar bill and the material things of this world, you're never happy. You're never happy, and you never will be happy. You're going to be the most miserable thing in the world. He said you ought to be content that you just got clothes and food on your table. But now you're trying to gain the whole world. And what did Jesus say? What would it profit a man if he should gain the whole world and lose his soul? What shall it profit him? Not a thing, because once again, he's going to leave it all behind. So contentment is rooted in sufficiency. Contentment comes when we can honestly say, as Paul says, I know how to live on almost nothing. I know how to live on almost nothing. Or he says, I've learned also to live having everything. He was a wealthy man prior to him becoming a Christian. He was a wealthy man. And no doubt he could have still been a wealthy man. But he says, whatever state I have found myself in, whether I have just minimal stuff or if I had a whole lot, I've learned to be content. And I learned how to be content with a grateful heart, thanking God for those things he has placed in my life. He said, I've learned the secret of living in every situation, whether it was a full stomach or an empty stomach or with plenty or little, I have learned how to be content, because if God be for me, then what can be against me? Contentment is rooted in sufficiency when we have a heart of gratitude. Listen to what he said in 1 Thessalonians 5:18. Be thankful in all circumstances. Be thankful in all circumstances. Did you get that? Not just in the good times, but even in the bad times. Be thankful. I know it's hard to be thankful when you're going through a trial, isn't it? We don't think about it being thankful during that time. We're thinking about the situation we find ourselves in. But listen to what God is telling us. He says, be thankful in all circumstances. Even in the worst time of your life, do you have a heart of thankfulness? A heart of gratitude. He also said rejoice. And again, I say rejoice. Even if you're going through the fiery trials of life, rejoice. Be thankful. Because it's a part of who we are in Christ. We are content whatever situation God is in, and we give him the praise and we give him the thanks, no matter what's happening. Boy, we got a lot to learn, don't we? We got a lot to learn. Be thankful in all circumstances. Listen to this, what he says right there in 1 Thessalonians 5:18 in the latter part. For this is God's, not the preacher's will, not the church's will, but this is God's will for you who, he says, who belong to Christ Jesus. Do you belong to Jesus? Then he said, be thankful in all circumstances, because it's the will of God for you. It's the will of God for you. And listen to what he says in Matthew 25, 23. The master said, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Do you want to hear God say those words to you? Because he says, you have been faithful in holding this small amount, so now I will give you many more responsibility. Let's celebrate together. Let's celebrate together. The master will say, well done, when you're grateful and thankful, even for the little things in life, even to the greater things. He says, the Lord honors you, and he will welcome you home with our good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over the little, so now you're going to be entrusted with the greater things that money can't buy. Money can't buy eternal life, can it? Money can't buy God's love. Did you get that? Money cannot buy God's love. But it's a free gift to those who obey his commandments. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments. If you love me, and if you belong to me, be thankful in all circumstances, and you will hear, welcome home, thou good and faithful servant. Such contentment is learned, as Paul tells us. He's learned how to be content. And he says not only contentment lies within learning about it, but it's sufficient. God is sufficient for all our needs and all our wants. God is sufficient. And when we look to him, we will be content. When we're not content, then we have a tendency to look for things that will bring contentment to our life. And the only one that can bring real contentment to your life is Jesus Christ. Contentment will always triumph over wants and desires. We all have desire and want things, don't we? So contentment is not denying one's feeling about wants and desires or what they can't have. Instead, it exhibits a freedom from being controlled by those items. Now, if those items, that desire and that want, controls your life, then you're probably on the wrong track. Are you with me? But if you want something and you desire something, but you're grateful for what God has placed in your life, and you're grateful for those things, I see no reason why He won't give you what you want and what you desire. I'm going to prove it to you in just a minute. It might say I'm contradictory, but it's not. If you're grateful for what you have right in the present that God has blessed you with, and you're content with that, but maybe you want something down the road. Maybe you want something. Maybe you want a new home, a new car, new set of clothes, whatever. But you're grateful, and you'll wait until the Lord gives you the okay to go get them. Then you are content. But when those desires and wants starts to drive your life, and that's all you concentrate on, and that's all you're going for, and you're forgetting to be grateful for what you have and being thankful to God for what He's blessed you with, then you're controlled by the wrong spirit. You're controlled by the world's God at that moment, in that time. You're not controlled by the God of the universe. Hello? Who owns it all and wants to bless you with it. So I'd rather wait on the Lord. They that wait on the Lord will renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall walk and not faint. So I want to wait on the Lord. It's timing. It's the key to being blessed. Contentment is a matter of accepting from God's hand what He sends, because we know He is a good God and wants to give His children good gifts. Paul had an enduring contentment, a deep-down, soul-satisfying contentment. And this kind of a contentment can only come from within. The source of this contentment is a soul-satisfying relationship with Jesus Christ. The most important thing that we should ever desire is salvation. That should be our heart's desire. Each and every human being should have a desire to have Jesus Christ in their heart so they can have eternal life with Jesus Christ. If not, you're doomed, and hell will be your home. When we have that deep down soul satisfying contentment and we have salvation, God's going to bless us in this world and in the world to come. Paul says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So my want and the desire, if I've learned to be content, and if I learn that what He has blessed me with is sufficient, some of my wants and desires will be met by Him, because He will strengthen me and He will enable me to get the desires of my heart. Why is that? Because I delight myself in Him. Listen to what the psalmist says in Psalms 37:4. Delight thyself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. Did you get that, church? Delight thyself in the Lord, and He will give you desires of your heart. I like what Paul sums up chapter 4, basically, you know, when he gets down to 19th verse. He says, not only can I do all things through Christ, but he says in verse 19 of chapter 4, he says these words. He says, but my God shall supply all of my needs, all of my need, according to His riches and glory. He's going to supply all of my needs, but He'll also give me the wants and desires of my heart if I honor Him. If I honor Him. Friend, today, do you honor God? Are you content? Or is your desires and wants driving your life away from God? Remember, the material things will burn up. What's important is the spiritual things. So learn to be content with what God has given to you. Then you might get the dreams of your life. The dreams of your life. Because contentment has to be learned. Contentment has learned the lesson that Jesus is enough. And when you got contentment in your heart, you know Jesus is enough. If you know Jesus, you have a God who hears you, the power of love behind you, and the Holy Spirit within you, and all of heaven ahead of you. So don't settle for less. Don't settle for less when there's so much to gain. There's so much gain. If you have Jesus, you have grace for every sin. Listen to me, church, in closing. You have grace for every sin. You have direction for every turn. And you have an anchor from every storm. And most of all, a light to lead you home. To lead you home. This world is not my home. I'm just passing through. When you have Jesus, you have everything you will ever need. Until you learn that, you'll never be happy. Paul said, I've learned Christ is sufficient for all of my needs. I am sufficient because I have Christ. And listen to this. Amen. Third thing. He says, contentment will always triumph over my wants and desires. I may want it, but I might not need it. And if God don't give it to me, that's fine. If he gives it to me, I'm going to be thankful. And if I delight myself in him, he will give me desires of my heart. So whatever I need, whatever I have, I'm thankful. And whatever God wants to bless me in the future with, I'll be grateful. God loves us, church. God loves us. He wants the best for us, but he wants us to put him first. Is he first in your life? If he's first in your life, then you learn how to be content because he's all you'll ever need. Let us stand. Heavenly Father, God, as we come to you today, Lord, we are grateful and thankful, Lord, for the words you've given to us, Lord. As Paul encouraged the church to keep up the good work,